Have you ever been drawn in by the captivating charm of the film look? There is a certain magic in its richness, vibrance, and that unmistakable cinematic punch. Is it the deep colors, the captivating contrast, or perhaps the rush of nostalgic emotions that make film emulations an irresistible journey for creators? Today, we're unraveling this magnetic force, exploring the simple yet powerful elements that elevate the ordinary to the extraordinary. Stick around, because by the end of this video, you'll not only grasp the impact of film emulation, but also discover the newest and best way to infuse that cinematic punch into your own creations. Today I want to introduce you to my new film Powergrade, specifically designed for Davinci Resolve. We got three different clips, three different cameras, and three different environments, but only one Powergrade to make them all look beautiful. So first up, I'm going to apply the Powergrade to all three shots. I'm going to come up to my gallery, and you could either right click and go to apply grade, or middle mouse button, just select that. I'm going to do that for all three of those shots. Right off the bat, you might think that some look really horrible, and that is true. I'm not gonna deny that. That's like a fact for everyone that has eyes, but that's because we have to set our input color space correctly. Because right now the input color space is set to Blackmagic Design White Gamut Gen 4 Gen 5. However, this was shot on an Arri, so I'm gonna use Arri White Gamut 4 and Arri Log C4. The image is way too overexposed. We're gonna fix that in our exposure node right here. But in this case, I'm just gonna use my offset wheel to bring that to a desired look, like so. Probably around there, looks pretty good to me. Now the contrast just does what it says. It adds a little bit more contrast to the image overall. Saturation just reduces the saturation a little bit to around 45, and that's because it looks really good in harmony with the density added later on. When your image asks for white balancing, you could do so in node number 3, the white balance node. I decided to go for the chromatic adaptation OFX that's built into DaVinci Resolve instead of using the offset wheel, and that's simply just because I get more precise representation than using my offset wheel or the temp and tint slider, in my subjective opinion. Now I can go up here to the Kelvin slider and slide that towards the right to warm up the image slightly, or slide it towards the left to cool down the image a little bit. Now, very important here is that the current color space in gamma is set to the color space we're working in, which is white gamut intermediate, because a note prior to that, we outputted DaVinci White Gamut Intermediate. So currently we're working in White Gamut Intermediate, and using that will give you some pretty good results. Node number 7 is deactivated by default, which is a slight film blur if you want to take off that digital edge that appears when you're shooting with a digital camera rather than a real film camera. You can activate the blur node and increase or decrease the blur strength. Node number 8 to 11 are empty nodes that are just there for as a placeholder, or where you can do your creative adjustments later on. Then we continue with two density nodes. The first one, let's just deactivate the second one. This is experimental. I just, within this compound node, I split the image into its two main components, Luma and Chroma, and then used the RGB mixer to dial down the density amount that I want to have. Or you could just use the version 2, which is operating in HSV color space, where you can use the gain wheel to dial in the amount of saturation that you're going for. Then we're gonna go for a couple matrix adjustment using the neon suppression XML file that's built into DaVinci Resolve. Even though it displays the LUT icon at the bottom right here, it technically is not a LUT, and you can find that in your LUTs folder right here, LMT neon suppression. Then we have the lab adjustments, hue and luminance. So in the lab hue, we're shifting around some colors. We're actually in the CIE lab color space, and we can use our blue output here. Probably if we wanna add some more flip teal, can increase that to around 34 and decrease this to the proportional number, which would be 66 in this case. Just make sure that whatever changes you're doing, the number down here always will add up to 1. Now if we want to do a before and after, this is before, this is after. We've just introduced a little bit more of that teal into the image, and then Lab Luma, we're just affecting the luminance that we've from the hues that we've shifted around in the note before. Focus on her skin, especially her lips and her fingers here. We can decrease the green to around 0.39 and then add blue output to the according number, 0.39. And now watch at her lips as we brought in a little bit more life into them than they already have. Saturation fix just fixes overly saturated areas in your image. I have that on by default. Halation, well, that's like the basic halation that you will find in DaVinci Resolve. If you don't have the studio version, you don't have access to that halation. Neither do you have access to noise reduction, which is the first note, or note number 27, which is gray note down here. Soft clip, just sometimes when you're shooting in very harsh conditions or you have a practical light in your scene, the light source will clip. However, making use of the high soft in the custom curves section gives that just a nicer roll off, a nicer overall roll off instead of a harsh edge. Just look at the highlights up here in the background. When I bring this all the way down, you can see that we have a more harsher edge. And if we bring this up, we have a more smooth gradient. Then we have our output device transform, where we transform DaVinci Wide Gamut and DaVinci Intermediate, which is our working color space, into Blackmagic Design Wide Gamut Gen 4 and Film Gen 5. Because as I've already said, I mainly shoot on Blackmagic cameras. And so the following LUTs are specifically designed to work on those cameras. And here you got two sets of LUTs, the Kodak 2383 and the Fuji 3513. Just make sure that only one of them is active at a time. And if you right click Show Compound Node, you will find 10 Kodak 2383 LUTs. As well as if you right click on this node, you'll find 10 Fujifilm 3513 LUTs. Nonetheless, let's go back and let's adjust a little bit of the look in the LUT section. So I'm gonna go to my K23 Show Compound node, and the Vision 3 has a lot of teal by default in the shadow regions. If you wanna go for more of a clean look, highly recommend the Actor one, as it doesn't have that much amount of teal. However, we can sip through them. The Eternal one gives a little bit more life to the overall image. The Mono is just a black and white. The Bleach is just a bleach bypass look. Film 1, 2, just sipping through them so you can see them in action, what they're doing to the image. But I feel like in this case, I might go for the Actar one. Or say you wanna have the Fujis on, just deactivate the K23, activate the F35. Show combo node, and then you can step through them one by one as well. So I feel like I like the bleach bypass look, so let's just stick with that. So the next two nodes, warmer and cooler, are not for white balancing your image. These are stylistic options that you can do after the fact that you've white balanced your image. Now on the warmer node, you can add some warmth to the highlights, or on the cooler node, you can cool down the image just a little bit. However, both of those nodes are set to 0.5. By default, let's just set them back to 1 so you can split the difference. This is off and this is a little bit warmer. Set that back to 0.5 and then go over to the cooler node, activate that, set that to 1 and now deactivate that and activate that so you can see the difference. However, I feel like I'm gonna leave both of them off for now. And then down here, you got some basic sharpening if you want to resharpen the image. You got some basic grain settings. We also got a glow node, which is currently set to soft light. And that's it. That's a really beautiful image, but we can easily change the look of it by choosing a different LUT like that. And now let's move on to the second shot. And this shot was shot on the Sony FX6. So I have to change my input device transform once again to Sony S-Gamut 3 Cine, and then Sony S-Log 3. Then we can choose our neon suppression, lab hue, and lab luma. And by default, this looks okay. However, I feel like it's a little bit too much on the teal side, but I'm still gonna increase that a little bit by going into my lab hue and decreasing the blue output to 66 right there. And then I'm gonna choose a different LUT because I know that the Vision 3 already has a lot of teal built into it, and I'm gonna use the Acta one, which looks pretty good. Then we can cool off the image a little bit and set the key output to 1 like so, and that's already looking very, very beautiful. However, if you don't like that, we can also use some of the Fuji LUTs, and I think that looks already really fantastic. I think we don't have to do any changes in on this shot anymore. Now let's move on to the next shot, which looks absolutely way too oversaturated. This was shot with the Blackmagic Ursa Mini 4.6K. So we have to set our input color space to, what is it, 4.6K Film Gen 3, and then our input gamma to 4.6K Film. We're still too saturated, so I'm gonna go into my density node, and I'm just gonna reduce my gain a little bit. Probably like that, it's looking really good. Then I can activate neon suppression, lab hue, lab luma, and then do a couple of changes in here. Once again, bring down my blue output to around 19, and then I'm gonna go to 81, like that is looking really good. I'm gonna do some changes in the luma now. I'm gonna bring this down to around 36, and I'm gonna increase that to around 36. What else could we do? We can make the image just a little bit warmer. I'm gonna go into my white balance node, and I'm gonna increase ever so slightly to around here. Looks pretty good. Now I feel like we're gonna use one of the Fuji LUTs. So I'm gonna go into show compound node, and I'm gonna use the Agdar one. That looks pretty good to me. And then we can see that our shadows are a little bit too far down, so we can go into exposure LGG and go into our HDR palette, see where the dark areas are, these, and then just lift them by half a stop, like so. That looks pretty good to me. And now we can warm up the image by using our warmer node, probably increase the key output just a little bit, like so. And now that's looking really good. We can add a little bit of grain to this scene and a little bit of glow. And right now we have a perfect image that's ready to go and move on to the next shot. And if you've watched this far, I seriously appreciate the support, and I just want to say thank you. Thank you with a custom discount code that you can see on screen right now. It's giving you 25% off just for the people who've watched this far. It works on all items in my store, whether you want to get the Powergrade, the LUT bundle, or the single LUT packs. Also, if you've watched this far, let me know what you think about the Powergrade and the LUTs in a comment below this video. Thank you so much, and I hope to see you next week. Bye.